This is an implanted insulin pump. Devices like this have been vastly improving the lives of hundreds of thousands of diabetic patients all around the world. It is literally a piece of life-changing technology. Just like any other technology, it can be hacked. Meet Jay Radcliffe, a security researcher, a hacker like me. Jay happens to be a type 1 diabetic patient, so he wears such a pump every day. 3 years ago at a hacker conference, he wowed the audience by demonstrating how he was able to hack his own pump. Using a simple laptop and a radio transmitter, Jay was able to remotely suspend any insulin delivery capabilities, effectively turning it off. Well, this got a lot of hackers interested in hacking medical devices. And a few months later, another hacker, infamous, a guy called Barnaby Jack, had to take it one step further. So for Barnaby Jack's demonstration, he brought a bigger radio antenna. With it, he was able to remotely command insulin pumps to release any remaining insulin in the reservoir into the demo patient's bloodstream. Up to 300 units of insulin could have potentially fatal results. But don't worry, nobody was really hurt in this demonstration. Always keen on pushing the borders of security research further, last summer, the same Barnaby Jack was scheduled to deliver another frightening presentation. This time, he would attempt to hack implanted cardiac defibrillators. His idea was to remotely send a signal that will trigger a high voltage electric shock, about 830 volts to be exact. However, just 1 week before Jack's presentation, he was found lifeless in his apartment in San Francisco. Nobody knows what happened. Sounds like the dramatic plot twist for a recent TV show, right? But this story is real, and these attacks are real as well. So real, in fact, that in 2007, when the former US Vice President Dick Cheney had his defibrillator replaced, his doctor made sure that any wireless signaling capabilities are completely disabled so that they could prevent a potential remote assassination attempt. That was in 2007, 7 years ago. Right now, there are millions of people all around the world that depend on devices like this for their everyday activities. Millions of potentially affected patients. Yet only 2 years ago, after those hackers' public demonstrations, did the general public become aware of the threat. Only 2 years ago did the United States Government Accountability Office issue their stern report warning the FDA and medical device companies of the potential threats from such cyber attacks into medical devices. Well, that makes you think, doesn't it? The obvious conclusion from these stories is that we can expect bugs to exist anywhere we rely on technology. So we should be afraid of the people who can find them. However, I am here today to offer a different perspective. Yes, hackers right now are not just looking for your credit card details or your email password. They are actively researching technologies connected to the human body. But that doesn't have to be a bad thing. In fact, one could argue that with all of the new technologies and the recent developments you heard about today, there's no single government agency or even device manufacturer that could possibly identify all of the potential security flaws. But consider the potential of hundreds, if not thousands, of curious hackers actively looking at these new technologies, eager to uncover and report the vulnerabilities they find. I like to think about hackers as elements in a complex immune system for the information age. Working in a distributed manner, they still find those vulnerabilities and those bugs. And I think we need them to do just that. They're pushing forward the evolution of technology by reporting on such vulnerabilities. But there's something more here to be told. A hacker, by definition, is someone who is not afraid to imagine new ways to use technology. That's why I think there's a greater story, and I'd like to share it with you today. When I first got interested in the hacker world, I was deeply inspired by science fiction stories. My fictional hacker heroes would be able to directly connect their nervous system to the global networks, even before there was a World Wide Web. William Gibson wrote about it in his 1982 Neuromancer. I imagined how future digital technologies will allow us to enhance and upgrade our physical and mental capabilities. I've been waiting for that reality to come true since I was a little kid. But right now, we are literally around the corner from technologies that will make it so. And it is surprisingly the biohackers who are bringing that reality closer to us today. So I'd like to show you what biohackers can do. People like Amal Grafstra. In 2005, Amal got tired of losing his car keys. I know it happens to everyone. So he got one of the identification chips, like you might have for your dog or your house cat. He had this radio frequency identification chip implanted in his left hand, and he used it to unlock the door to his house and open his car. A few years later, he got another chip installed, an upgrade. This time, he used near-field communication capability. This means he could now unlock his cellular phone or log into his laptop. But that was a few years ago. Right now, using a crowdfunding campaign, Amal has developed the next generation of human implantable RFID chip. Smaller than a grain of rice, this device combines the capability of radio frequency identification with near-field communication. That means the hundreds of his crowdfunding supporters will now be able to communicate with their phones and their laptops, turn off the lights in their living room. They'll be getting these in the mail in the next few months. But kids, don't try implanting these at home. Instead, next time you visit a hacker conference, for $30 and a signed liability waiver, you can get one there. These are quite common in the hacker community right now. But of course, identification and connectivity is not enough for hackers. They're always looking for new capabilities. And that's what this young lady chose to do. Her nickname is Left Anonym. She is a Scottish-born do-it-yourself cyborg. That means she has conducted experiments on her body at home in order to increase and add more senses to what is humanly possible. How could she achieve this? Well, apparently it was relatively simple, and she used a kitchen knife. In the tips of her fingers, Left implanted metal discs. This metal was actually a rare earth magnet called neodymium, and it reacts in the presence of electromagnetic radiation. That means that a few days after the implementation, Left was physically able to sense electromagnetic fields, like a live electric wire, or even the radiation emanating from a cellular tower, if it's strong enough. I call that the perfect sixth sense for the 21st century. Now, this device takes it even one step further. Again, designed by biohackers in a garage called Grindhouse Wetware in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. This little implant is designed to sit within the human body and directly track biological indicators like temperature or blood sugar levels. It then sends these pieces of data directly over Bluetooth to a connected smartphone. Useful, I'd say, but this is just the first prototype. And true to hacker values, it is completely open source. That means any hacker in the world can download the source code and the schematics and collaborate or upgrade for their own model. And if you were wondering what it might look like, here's the first prototype. This is moments after the first implementation. And this is the first ever homemade human-machine interface that's developed, designed, and implanted by hackers. What you're seeing right now is the designer, Tim Cannon, already using this device to track data from his body and transmit it to his iPad. So at this point, you might think the biohackers I told you about are reckless, dangerous even. They are not afraid to connect man and machine. And hackers have always done this. They've always gone beyond the cutting edge and literally to the bleeding edge. Hackers are on the bleeding edge of technological innovation. They've always been there. So it's no surprise at all they are hacking the human body and coming up with new ways to use it. In fact, in 10 or 20 years' time, we might all have such devices. And that means Tim, Amal, and Left are only the early adopters, the first visionaries, if you will. And they are not alone. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of other biohackers all around the world, from London to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. They are actively pushing forward the boundaries of what can be done with medical technology. And they're doing this outside of the labs and the academic institutions. They're blurring the boundaries between organic and synthetic. And I find it exciting. So here's my bottom line. In the next few years, technology will allow us to completely reinvent the human body. We will be able to fix what is broken or upgrade what we don't like. Now, like any new field, like any new revolution, there will be ethical, moral, and scientific questions that will need answering, no doubt. But some of that groundbreaking pioneering will come from the hacker spaces and the garages. So I think it is time for the medical community to take a good look at what's happening in the biohacker underground. I've just shown you a glimpse of what they are capable of doing. Can you imagine what you can do together? Thank you.